The oldest political party in New Zealand, Labour's roots were forged on the West Coast. Times were hard and many Kiwis worked and lived in appalling conditions. Labour fought for a fair New Zealand. Food, clothing, shelter, and a living wage for all. Wellington watched helplessly as unemployment gripped the nation.
This is no burlesque of life. This was life in New Zealand.
Into the political vacuum swept Michael Joseph Savage, and New Zealand had its first Labour government.
Our mission is to build and not to destroy the social structure.
Pulling the country out of depression, Labour's vision for the future became the New Zealand way of life.
Under a Labour government which puts people before things, the health services claim a high priority.
Labour addressed the housing shortage by building thousands of homes.
For the family man, nothing gives so much satisfaction as a house to himself and a garden to break in.
From free milk for school children to the world's first social security legislation, Labour's New Zealand boasted high living standards and one of the smallest gaps between rich and poor on the planet.
For young people of ability, the Labour government has ensured free entrance to the university.
After Savage's death, Peter Fraser took the helm.
New Zealand is appreciated very highly because of its leadership and social progress.
He pushed for New Zealand command over Kiwi troops and tried to ensure they weren't treated as cannon fodder. Labour was still in power when our boys came home and made sure there were opportunities to greet them. The country showed its gratitude by putting them back into power. In just 14 years, Labour had built a prosperous, thriving nation. But by 1951, National was in power and at war on the wharves. 22,000 men were off the job. National made it illegal to help the wives and children of the workers. Under Walter Nash, the second Labour government focused on local production, but a tax on cigarettes and alcohol was well ahead of its time, and the 60s went to National. Labour came back with Norman Kirk, a man of the people. Big Norm tackled the housing shortage, gave pensioners a Christmas bonus, and created a superannuation scheme that would be a $240 billion asset today if National hadn't dismantled it.
I don't think we want to see in New Zealand industries taken over by a pension board.
The Muldoon years polarised the country. Labour won the popular vote in 78 and 81, but National moved the electoral boundary goalposts and maintained power. In 1981, goalposts split the country in two. After 9 years of National, the economy was on the verge of collapse. David Longhi and Labour came to power, introducing groundbreaking social reforms. Finance Minister Roger Douglas restructured the economy. But his free market policies and asset sales didn't belong with Labour. The party was divided, and ultimately, Douglas left to form ACT. Longhi resigned, but would be remembered for declaring New Zealand nuclear-free. During the 90s, National continued to sell off state assets.
This is going to be the mother of all budgets, yes, as they say, duh.
Unemployment skyrocketed while benefits were slashed. It was the era of market rents for state homes. Evictions, hospital charges, and the erosion of workers' rights. Labour was swept back into power. The party had returned to its core values. They lowered state house rents and raised the minimum wage. There was a budget surplus, and New Zealand had the lowest unemployment in the OECD. Labour was back, and people mattered more than ideology.